You're good.
Good morning, Facebook Live. Later, YouTube. Oh, we'll just leave that. I won't leave it. It's a prayer request. I won't leave that on the ground. Okay. Here we go. So, I want to start off. I'm going to get right into the word today. I want to start off because worship was powerful and mighty, and His presence is always here. He's always moving. He was healing today. He was performing miracles. He's delivering today His people. So thank you, Jesus, for your miracle-working power in people's lives. Father, I just lift up this service. I ask that you would speak in and through me by your Holy Spirit, none of me and all of you, Father, in Jesus' mighty name. I pray that the hearts would receive, ears would hear, and that people would be forever changed in your presence. But I want to start off by saying thank you for Rose. I thanked her personally, but I want to thank you for giving the time that you gave over the last couple of weeks to this congregation. Rose preached and taught about the king and his kingdom, and she did a wonderful job of describing how kings and their kingdoms operate. And she included holiness in the end of that, of her teaching. And I know some people that I know, like family members, and people were concerned that I might have been sick. Are you okay? You haven't been behind the pulpit in a couple of weeks. But Rose, God had put a message on her heart anyways a while ago, and so she was preparing for that. And she gave credit to Dr. Miles Monroe, and you did it with just, it was wonderful, Rose, so thank you. I appreciate you. And she also was very helpful to me because our school started this past week, and it gave me opportunity to hustle like I always have to. This is the busiest time of year, going right into the school year and the start of the school year, one of the busiest times. And so it gave me the opportunity to take care of that. So, Rose, thank you very much. And but it was also very fitting because, you know, God has put on my heart that we truly need to understand how Jesus is the King of Kings. Capital K, King. He's the King with the capital K. He's the King of Kings with the lower K. And He is the Lord of Lords. And Jesus has a kingdom, and it operates the way that we were just taught over the past 2 weeks. And so if you didn't get to see it on Facebook, it's public. I make my Facebook public so people can see the preaching. And go back, you'll see me first. You'll see the little Italian pop up, but then you'll see a tall blonde for 2 weeks in a row. And just scroll down, and you'll please watch them. It really gives you a good foundational basis of the kingdom and what kingdoms look like for a king and what a king does and how he operates and how his kingdom operates. When you understand that, you understand how our King Jesus operates and what it's like in his kingdom. And so Jesus's kingdom, the kingdom of heaven, operates the way a kingly kingdom should. God is a God of order. He's a God of rank. And you know, Pastor Linda always used to say, don't break rank. Don't break rank, because there's ranking in the kingdom. No one's above Jesus. No one is higher or stronger than our King. And God wants us to know that. Because why? As believers, if we know who our King is, who we serve, do you think we're really going to worry about enemy attacks? The Bible says that the attacks will come, but we don't have to worry about it. We have authority over it. Why? Because it's been given to us through our King, King Jesus. So as believers, we need to understand God's kingdom and his kingdom dynamics so that we will walk in our authority as heirs to the kingdom. Now, heirs, H-E-I-R-S, heirs to the kingdom. I do that for the children. Well, the one that's laying down there, I don't know. So, you know, I teach them that sometimes that H is silent. So they're not heirs to the kingdom. They're heirs to the kingdom. And so we have to know how to walk in our authority. So open up with me to Romans 8, if you would. Be so kind to open up to Romans 8. And we're going to go to 12. We're going to read 12 through 17. I'm reading in the New King James Version. And the title in my Bible is Sonship Through the Spirit. So Romans 8, 12 through 17. Therefore, brethren, we are debtors not to the flesh to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit, capital S, you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. Now, we've been talking before Rose preached about the kingdom. We talked about the flesh, and that's one of the sins that we can fall by. The flesh of our flesh wants what it wants, and we have to put that down. We have to choose to put that down. So, for as many in verse 14, for as many as are led by the Spirit, the Holy Spirit of God, these are sons of God. For you did not receive the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you received the spirit of adoption by whom we cry out, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs. Heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. If indeed we suffer with him, that we may also be glorified together. Now, as Christians, we don't always want to hear that we're suffering with him, right? But I have heirs. I want to talk about heirs a little bit. But hold on a second. So we live by the Spirit, which is the Word. Now, I like to say capital W, the Word, because Jesus is the Word. Correct? He's the Word. He's alive, and he's living. He is seated in heavenly places with Christ Jesus. That's where we're seated. And he's seated at the right hand of the Father because all authority has been given to him. But he's alive. He left his word for us. And this is powerful. That's why when things are going wrong, you know, if your finances are being hit, you pull up financial scriptures and you decree and declare them. Because it's already written. It's alive. And his word has power. Amen. Healing for your body. We just prayed that. Now, the flesh is the opposite. It's based on our five senses, our physical senses. So we don't want to move by what our flesh wants. We want to move by the Spirit, by the Holy Spirit. And it takes training. So in verse 17, it had said, if we are children of God, we were adopted, then we're heirs. And if we're heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, indeed, we will suffer with him that we may also be glorified with him. So Jesus is glorified. So are we. And so I want to talk to you real quick about heirs. And in Strong's, the Greek, you know, I always slaughter the Greek. S-U-N-K-L-E-R-O-N-O-S for those who are taking notes. But it's joint participant. A co-heir, a fellow heir, one who receives a lot with another. And then in dictionary.com, it says it's a person who inherits or has a right of inheritance in the property of another following the latter's death. Now we know Jesus died, but he rose again, correct? And then a person who inherits or is entitled to inherit the rank, the title, the position, etc., of another, inheriting the tradition and the talent, etc., of the predecessor. This is what we've inherited with Jesus. See, when you think of everything that Jesus did when he walked this earth, that's what we can do. He said that we would do those things and even greater when he went to the Father. We know that in the Word. We are meant to be the church, and we are meant to be doing what Jesus did and greater. Amen? So Jesus was the firstborn of many brothers and sisters. Not only physically, because he was our firstborn brother physically, he came to earth, but spiritually. And when we receive the free gift of salvation from Jesus, we become joint heirs of the kingdom. It's as simple as that. We receive Jesus by faith. Salvation is by faith. But when we do it, it's supernatural, and we become joint heirs. So we will have two choices. And when we become joint heirs, we're in the Father's kingdom now. Do you understand that? Because the Bible tells us that we're seated in heavenly places with Christ Jesus. Well, where is he? I just told you, right? He's at the right hand of the Father. Where are you? We're there too. We're here, but in the Spirit we're there. So when we're praying, do you realize we're supposed to be praying based on the kingdom? We pray kingdom dynamics. That's why we pray you already are healed. You were healed over 2,000 years ago. Why? Because by his stripes, you are healed. Well, why do we think, why are we carrying anything around? I get furious when a saint of God gets sick and goes home prematurely. I feel like it doesn't give my Father glory. And I feel like there's that mocking that goes on. I hate when God gets mocked. You know what I mean? I don't think it brings glory that my sister went home to glory prematurely. I don't. I was praying, we were praying resurrection life, weren't we, for her? And you know what? I don't know. I think there are times where as a church and as the body of Christ, we've allowed our even ourselves to think that the enemy is stronger than our God. Or people and the things they say are stronger than our God. Or people that practice witchcraft or divination, they're not stronger than our God. Satan is not stronger than our God. Did you know that? Yeah, he's been defeated. The keys were stripped from him. Jesus stripped the keys. So, when we become saved, we have two choices. We can either walk by the Spirit, or we can choose to walk in the flesh. Now, when you first get saved, it's supernatural, and it takes time. It's called a sanctification process. So we kind of start off in the flesh. But as we're spending time in his word and in his presence and worshiping and locking into small groups, I want to get small groups started soon. We've been talking about it. I hate talking about it and talking about it and talking. I just want to do it. Let's get it done. Let's get it done. You know what I'm saying? A care pastor was set up with Pastor Linda. Debbie was the care pastor. I want to get this done, man. New people come in. Okay, care pastor, go. Go. Care for them. Because you know what? Right now we're small and I can care for you. I know you guys get probably sad and annoyed with me because I'm always so busy. But some people shoot me texts and I shoot texts back, don't I, Winona? I always shoot texts back. It might take me a while. But, you know, it's hard because, you know, I'm doing a lot. So I need people under. You guys have been trained. You're not supposed to sit on your little dupas. For how many years has this been? A lot. We're old now. Our church is old. We're tiny. We're mighty, but we're old. You can lead now. Woo! You should have been leading a long time ago. So here's the deal. You're going to get off your dupas, and you're going to, because you know what? If the flock just sits there and gets fed, what happens if you just keep feeding a sheep and feeding a sheep and feeding a sheep, and they don't do anything? They don't run around and move their bodies around. They're going to get big, weighed down, and they're going to flop over. I don't want a bunch of fat sheep. I want you lean, mean, and fighting machines for Jesus. Okay? So you guys are going to start doing, because you've been equipped. You've been equipped for many, many years now. It's time to help. It's time to lead. It's time to lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. Listen, after today's message, if you say, Pastor, I need you to pray for a sick person, I'm going to say, and what's wrong with you? I mean, of course, I'll pray for a sick person. But the same Jesus that's in me, he's in you. Point to yourself. Say, Jesus is in me. The Holy Spirit is in me. I've got his power. I've got the power. You know I was going there. Kobe always knows. You've got the power. You have the power of the kingdom inside of you. Okay? Whoo! Sweating up here. It's getting Pentecostal up here. All right, here we go. So, I wrote down these scriptures to make it a little quicker. Ephesians 3:6. that the Gentiles should be fellow heirs of the same body and partakers of his promise in Christ through the gospel. Now this was the Apostle Paul, and he goes on to say in verse 7, of which I became a minister according to the gift of the grace of God given to me by the effective working of his power. That's his power. And Apostle Paul was Saul. We know his name was changed from Saul to Paul, but when he was Saul, he persecuted the church. He was terrible to Christians, to the followers of Jesus, of Yeshua. He was terrible to them. Well, he had an experience with God, with Almighty God, with King Jesus. And he went from Saul to Paul. And when he went from Saul to Paul, there was a change. There was a shift. And he was operating in the kingdom dynamics. And he was operating in God's power, in the power of Jesus was operating through him. Because Paul didn't walk around with Jesus. The other apostles did, but he did not. And then, you know, the enemy meant for him to be persecuting. You know, there are some of you, you've been praying for people in your family or relatives. You know, I don't know if they'll ever get saved. I don't know if they'll ever get saved. They will. Don't lose hope. Because you know what? For, you know, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Our house, you know, years ago, we live with just our small families now. But years and years ago, traditionally, people had generations in their home. And so as for you and your house, you will serve the Lord. They will serve the Lord. Amen? And so God the Father appointed Jesus as heir of all things. He is the heir of all things, not some things, not a few things. He is the heir of all things. Say, Jesus is the heir of all things. Okay, so in Hebrews 1:2, we learn that we receive Jesus as our Savior by faith, right? And that God the Father appointed Jesus, okay? So now God the Father appointed his Son. He's seated at the right hand of the Father. He's been appointed as the heir of all things. That's why I go to King Jesus with everything, because he is appointed over all things. So Galatians 3:29, it says, and if we are Christ's, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. You know about Father Abraham. Father Abraham has many sons, and many sons have Father Abraham. You're one of them. And so you are Abraham's seed too, and you're heirs according to the promise. Galatians 4:5. To redeem those who were under the law, that we might receive the adoption as sons. Amen? You're not under the law anymore. And in verse 6, and because you are sons, God has sent forth the Spirit, capital S, of his Son, into your hearts, crying out, Abba, Father. Verse 7, therefore you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then you are an heir of God through Christ. Is anyone excited about this? You guys should feel more kingly after this message today. So we are joint heirs with our brother Jesus Christ. He's our brother. He's our big brother. And Jesus the Messiah, Yeshua, is on the throne in the kingdom of heaven, where he reigns forevermore. Jesus taught us to pray a model prayer. He taught us to pray the Our Father. And I'm going to just say a portion of it, not all of it. But I'm going to actually do the Christian Standard Bible version, okay? Our Father in heaven, your name be honored and holy. See, that's how we should be praying. Our God in heaven, our Father in heaven, your name be honored and holy, because he's holy. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We have to be more kingdom-minded. We have to be more kingdom-minded. We are supposed to be praying and advancing God's kingdom on earth. And we're supposed to be praying that his will be done. Jesus should be our focus, and God's will should be our focus. Now, some people may say, well, you can't, don't pray witchcraft prayers over people. Well, the only time you're praying witchcraft prayers is when you're trying to control someone and their will, okay? We don't go against somebody's free will. However, we are heirs to the throne, and we are supposed to be praying God's will be done. His kingdom come here on earth as it is in heaven. So parents, let me ask you this. Your children are going wayward. Do you let them just fly around with Satan? And the devil's ways, the world's ways? No. You start praying, Father, I thank you that my child is an heir to the throne. I thank you, Jesus, that your kingdom come here on earth as it is in heaven. And no one in heaven is following Satan in his ways. No one in heaven is following the world's ways. No one in heaven is hurting people, being mean to people, gossiping about people. No one in heaven is doing drugs. No one in heaven, that's pharmakia. No, that's sorcery. Sorcery is pharmakia, drugs. Did you know that? Legalization of marijuana. You think Jesus is up there smoking a fatty? He's not. Sorry. He's not. He's not up there toking. I'm sorry. I know Colby. Colby is like, oh my gosh. Behind the camera, he's like, why does she go there? Because sometimes you just gotta be real with the people. You gotta be real with the people, Colby. You know, he's not drinking a shot of whiskey. Jesus doesn't need whiskey. He doesn't need it. Jesus isn't shooting up. There's no needles in heaven. Do you see what I'm saying? He's not hurting people on purpose. He's not jealous of people. You know, when someone gets promoted, God up there, the Father and the Son are like, yeah, go, baby, go. Go, my kids. You know, if they're getting promoted and they're doing this and they're doing that, it's just like, I should have done that when I was down there. That's jealousy. You know, when you don't like when something good happens for someone else and you get that, I know it because I used to be a jealous person. I had to be delivered from that. Jealousy is ugly. The Bible tells us where jealousy and envy are, every evil thing abounds. It's true. When you're jealous of someone else, how can God promote you when you're jealous and you can't be happy for someone else's success? I tell you, when you start blessing people, oh, thank you, Father, that they got that promotion. I pray you bless them with even more money, Father. Oh, I thank you, Lord. Oh, look how she's dressing fine and fancy. I pray that you bless her more. Amen? We want to lift each other up with the kingdom dynamic. We got to start being kingdom focused. There's no sickness in heaven. There are no diseases in heaven. There's no depression in heaven. There's no worry in heaven. Do you see what I'm saying? There's no anxiety in heaven. None. None. I bet they're playing Don't Worry, Be Happy all day. Do, do, do. We played that for the kids. We were whistling, Don't Worry, Be Happy. I had a little one saying, but I'm sad. I go, no, don't be sad. Be happy. And so, you know, this is how we got to start. Could you imagine if in His Presence Church started walking around kingdom-minded 24/7? Someone comes up, oh, my God, this ache, and then, oh, in the mighty name of Jesus, be gone. No, that doesn't belong in the kingdom. Sorry, joint heirs can't have hip pains, knee pains, toe pains, nose pains, head pains. Someone's, I got a migraine. No, there are no migraines in the kingdom of heaven. Nope. Someone gets diagnosed, no, there are no cancers. There's no diabetes. People in the body of Christ own illnesses. Well, you know, I don't even want to say it. I'm not going to own anything. I'm not going to speak in front of her. I also have to rebuke myself. And Rose knows I'll spank myself, and she doesn't want me to do that in front of her brother. So sometimes I rebuke myself. I spank myself. So, you know, Rose is like, oh, don't do it. She'll spank herself. So, you know, I had someone ask me the other day, Mrs. Schwally's husband said, do you, because Ashley had said something and she rebuked herself. And he goes, do you do that? I go, oh, yeah. Oh, I rebuke myself in the name of Jesus. I go, sometimes I give myself a little spanking because I got to spank my flesh into submission. Because see, when we start, because sometimes, and it's easy, isn't it? You're talking to someone and they're depressed and then you're kind of like,
yeah, I think I feel sad too. I want to be sad, but no, I don't want to be sad.
I even tell Anne, she likes to watch things to make herself cry. I'm like, stop doing that. That's not fun. It's not fun, Anne. That's not what they do in the kingdom of God. You're joint heir with Jesus Christ. We have to be happy. We're no sad. We're not crying. Did you know we're not going to be crying up there? There's no more tears. There's no tears in heaven. We don't have to be sad. So we pray, your kingdom come, Lord. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So, Matthew 6:33 and Luke 12:31 say similar things here, but I'm going to read Matthew 6:33. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you. We are supposed to be seeking the kingdom of heaven first. You seek that kingdom of heaven first, and then all things will be added to you. What things? Well, you don't get, when you start seeking the kingdom of heaven first in God's ways, he'll take care of your business. He'll give you the food to eat. He'll make sure you have clothes on your back. He takes care of your needs. You know, the Father knows what we need before we even ask. Did you know that? He knows. He's God. Yo, our dad is awesome. Abba Father is amazing. His kingdom is the first thing that we seek. And then we don't have to worry. We can be happy and joyful. So what is the kingdom of God like? Jesus describes it a lot, and I'm giving you a few, but he really describes the kingdom. In Luke 13:20 through 21, he says, and again he said, to what shall I liken the kingdom of God? It is like leaven, which a woman took and hid in three measures of meal till it was all leavened. That's a kind of a hard version to understand. So I looked at the Passion Translation, and it says that Jesus taught, this is Luke 13:20 through 21, Jesus taught them another parable. How can I describe God's kingdom? God's kingdom is like something as small as yeast that a woman kneads into a large amount of dough. It works unseen until it permeates the entire batch and the loaf rises high. Isn't that cool? It's like 60 pounds of flour. That's what it equates to. We buy 5-pound bags, right? Yeah, we buy the little 5-pound bags of flour usually when we're baking. Picture 60 pounds of flour and the yeast is mixed in to the flour and you can't see what's happening. You cover it up and you let that dough rise, you know? You're all getting hungry, aren't you? For some homemade bread and pizza. But that dough rises and you can't see it. You don't know how it's happening, but it is. It's growing. Do you see that? That's what it's like in the kingdom. He also compares the kingdom of God to a mustard seed. You know how tiny a mustard seed is? We gave them out in little tiny glass jars. And he put it in his garden. It grew and it became a large tree. And the birds of the air nested in its branches. See, everybody should be flocking to us because we're like that little mustard seed that gets planted. Have a blessed day. Be safe. That little tiny mustard seed turns into a large tree. I preached a message on that. It's a big tree from a tiny, tiny mustard seed. That's the kingdom of God. So Jesus describes his kingdom as growing, potential for a very large kingdom. You know, I don't want anyone to ever say, well, you know, I mean, how many souls should we get saved? Because, I mean, is there room up in heaven? Yes. Yes, there's plenty of room. And he's God the Father. You know, where his kingdom is, there's no end. You know, if he ran out of space, don't you think God could say, oh, I need to expand my territory? That wasn't just Jabez, right? God can expand a territory for you. So in Mark 4, 26 through 32, we learn that the kingdom of God produces a harvest. It produces a harvest. And this speaks of God's supernatural character of God's kingdom. We are to sow the kingdom message. We share the gospel, right? We sow the kingdom message. And then God supernaturally will produce the final effects. Just like that yeast in the bread. We don't really even see how it's happening. And so the kingdom, and to be kingdom-minded is soul-winning. That's the largest part of God's kingdom. That's the most important thing to him. He wants souls won, and he wants his kingdom to grow and to keep growing. He's not satisfied. And I don't believe he's going to rapture his church out until he's a little bit more satisfied. And then even after we get raptured, people can still get saved. It'll be harder, but they'll get saved. Think about the people that don't get raptured, but they knew that they should have. They knew they messed up. They're going to know right away. I think they're going to give their hearts to the Lord right away. But then they're going to keep going. And then there's so many people, you know, the 144 will be preaching and getting souls saved. And there's so much more. So anyways, I'm not going to get into that, though. Another message for another day. So soul winning has to be our focus. That's the kingdom focus. We have to win souls. We have to win souls. And Willie, I'm going to get things done this year. I'm going to get things done. We're going to win souls. We're going to do it. So what are some other things in the kingdom dynamics? In Luke 12, 32, Jesus says, "Don't be afraid and do not fear, little flock, because your Father delights to give you the kingdom." He delights to give it to you. He wants you to have the kingdom. It's his good pleasure to give you the kingdom in another version. It brings him good pleasure. That was Luke 12, 32. I'm going to just speed through these a little bit. Luke 1, 33, "His kingdom will have no end. We will live for all eternity with our Heavenly Father." His kingdom has no end. You know when you're watching a great movie and you just don't want it to end? Well, that's how his kingdom is. It's never going to end. It's like that great movie that just goes on and on and on. Right? The kingdom of God will be proclaimed and the teaching about our Lord Jesus Christ with all boldness and without hindrance for all eternity. That's in Acts 28, 31. Acts 28, 31. Jesus, we're going to be taught by Jesus. Oh, I don't know. I don't know. I'm obnoxious. I'm going to want front row seat on that one. I'll be crawling up. Excuse me. Excuse me, pardon me. Because I'm going to have a glorified body, but I don't know how tall it's going to be. So I'm thinking I might still be small, and I might be able to still squeeze in. Excuse me, pardon me, excuse me, pardon me. Jesus is like, oh, here she comes. Here she comes. The tiny one is going to squeak through. Luke 11, 20. "If I drive out demons by the finger of God, then the kingdom of God has come upon you." See, driving out demons is what we're supposed to be doing by the finger of God. That's the kingdom. Colossians 1:13. "He has rescued us from the domain of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of the Son he loves." So he took you out of darkness and he transferred you to the kingdom of life. To his kingdom. That alone, and I'm going to end there today because I don't want to get too much into this kingdom dynamics because there's a lot with the kingdom and we're going to probably carry on with it if the Lord wills for me to do that. So, but basically, the kingdom is you're no longer in darkness. You are now a joint heir. You've been transferred to the kingdom of heaven. You're seated in heavenly places with Christ Jesus. You're a co-heir, a joint heir with Christ Jesus. The same things that Jesus did, you do, and greater here on earth. The kingdom dynamics is you pray healing for people, and they shall recover. You lay hands on the sick. The kingdom dynamic is people get delivered from demons, right? The kingdom dynamics is that you prosper in all things, even as your soul prospers. So you prosper financially, you prosper in your soul, your mind, your will, your emotions. You know, the body of Christ doesn't have to walk around with mental attacks, mental illness, mental disabilities. We don't have to do that. We have the mind of Christ. So when you're a joint heir, you're with your big brother Jesus. King Jesus is your brother. He's your big brother, King Jesus. You can go to him with anything. And you know, this was so heavy on my heart this morning that I really believe the Father wants you to know this. I touched upon it a little bit during praise and worship, but you know, there is this, like, and I don't know if it's a religious spirit, I don't know if it's deception, I don't know what it is, but sometimes God's children, his kids, they think they can't go to him with anything that's on their heart. And he says, no, 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 my child, you can. You know, you don't have to save the big things. Like, I don't want to go to God with too many prayers because when I really need him, well, here's a newsflash. We need him all the time. You really need him now. You really need him today in this moment. We need him all day from the time we open our eyes until the time we put ourselves to sleep. And then, you know, we need him in the night season. Do you know, in the night season, he shares his dreams and visions with you. And he gives you sweet sleep. A lot of people, their sleep is being stolen from them because of fear and anxiety and worry. That's not from God. The kingdom has so much to offer us. And we are kingdom carriers. When you receive Jesus, you receive the kingdom. You know, when Jesus was walking on the earth, he would tell them, if this happens, that means the kingdom has come to you. Jesus was the kingdom. He came to us. But now, because he died and he rose again and he resurrected, and we ask him into our heart supernaturally, he comes in just like that yeast. And the leaven, and the dough. And he works his stuff. He works his power. He works his miracle-making power. And we rise like beautiful dough. We grow. And our goal is to grow his kingdom for him. That's our job. That's our yab. Our job is to grow the kingdom of heaven for our Father. And our job is to share all the kingdom dynamics and everything that God wants for his children with those that are lost. And then we get them saved. And then we disciple them. You know, the decision is the best part, the first part. But then, you know, God wants us to make disciples, followers, disciplined ones, followers of Christ. So then we raise up and train up the disciples. And then they go out. So let's say you get one soul saved, right? You lead one person to Jesus. That person leads one person to Jesus. And then that person leads. Do you see how the kingdom can grow? But then how do you know? You don't know. The one person you might have gotten saved might be the next Catherine Kuhlman. Not, there's one Catherine Kuhlman. But you know what I mean? With that similar anointing. Or the next Billy Graham. You don't know who you're preaching the gospel to, right? And don't look at people out on the streets. Oh, those drug abusers, they're bums. Look at them, they're bums. Well, go get them saved. Because I've seen a lot of reformed drug abusers, and whoa, what they're doing for the kingdom. You don't know who these people are. Don't give up on the people that are, you know, the homeless people. Let's go get them. Let's go get them. Well, they're not in their right mind. Well, of course they're not in their right mind, but we carry the kingdom, and we can get them in their right mind. Not we, but Christ in us. We carry his power. We carry his glory. And then Father tells us, be holy, for I am holy. We should be earnestly seeking holiness for our lives. Let's get rid of those things that can kind of pull us away from holiness. Amen. Kind of going into what the next message will be, but this is the kingdom dynamics. This is what we're all about. This is what it's all about. Amen. Oh, Lord. Your little infant child. I had one of those. Oh boy. Baby boy. I still call him baby boy, even though he's going to be 20. But, you know, I'm proud of him. I'm proud of Jesus in him. You know, he's off to college, and, you know, now he's home. He's not dorming this year. But last year he wanted to dorm. I'm going to dorm, Mom. Okay, Justin. Adios. He came home every week. I was like, I thought you were dorming. But people are like, do you miss your son? Not really. I just dropped him off and he came home. I saw him. I pretty much see him a lot every week. So anyway, but I did miss him. But I have him home now. But I'm going to tell you, he was ministering the gospel on campus. And, you know, funny story, I won't share it, but, you know, a friend, you know, was under the influence of something. I think I see Jesus in the corner. Justin's like, well, I'm going to go with this. Yes. You see Jesus in the corner. He's calling you. And this is, he went with it. But hey, you do what you got to do. On college campuses, you minister a different way. But, you know, that's the thing. My kids have always had that anointing to, like, want to help people that are in trouble, help people that are, you know, that's just a natural thing for them. And so that's part of the kingdom dynamics. I just want to see my heart's cry to the Lord is, Father, help in His Presence Church really operate in the kingdom dynamics. Help in His Presence Church. Help the people know who Jesus is, know who they are in Jesus Christ, and then know what to do with this awesomeness that we have. I can't even describe him because he's so awesome. We have such an awesome God. Oh, dear God. We have an awesome God. And that's who you serve. So if your car breaks down or you get a flat tire or you wake up and you feel a scratchy throat, rebuke that thing. You know? Just ask the Father, Lord, I'm giving this to you right now. This doesn't belong to me. Because I'm a kingdom kid. I'm a king's kid. I'm a joint heir. And so you got to just know who you are. Do you think you can walk in that? I want to start seeing you guys walk in a little bit more kingly. King's kids walk in with confidence because they know who their father is. Yes, amen. You can walk with boldness because of who your dad is, who Abba is. Amen. Father, I pray that you would seal this word today. That it would seal to the hearts of your people. That those that don't know you, Father, would simply just reach out and ask for salvation. Everyone here today is saved, but if there are people out there that are watching, Father, that don't, they've never made a decision for you. Father, I pray that they would just say, Jesus, I need you. I've sinned and I have fallen short and I need you in my life. I don't know that I am a joint heir with Jesus. I want to be a joint heir with Jesus Christ. So I receive you today. I receive your free salvation. I receive that gift with gladness. And I ask you, Father, to help me be the best child of God that I can be. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen and amen. Let's keep it simple for people. Let's not make it hard. Let's not make Jesus hard. He's easy. He's wonderful. Let's share how wonderful he is. Amen. All right. It's time for the Lord's tithes.